So hello and welcome. Happy Friday. Today is Friday, June the 4th, and this is episode number 112 of Backyard Beekeeping Questions and Answers based on questions submitted by viewers sometime this past week. So there you have it. And if you're here on Podbean, which is my podcast, the way to be on podcasts, you can also post your own questions by going to thewaytobe.org and filling out a form there. So if you want to post a question, or you can write it down in the comment section below, right on this video. So I'm glad that you're here. And what else can we talk about? It's temperature outside, 78 degrees, and it's going to be super hot this weekend. So what am I doing in here? I need to be outside checking with the bees. But sharing with you is just as important, because some people look forward to this every Friday. And what happened last Friday? It took over 18 hours for me to upload the video. Hopefully that won't happen today. In fact, I'm prepared today to drive into the city just to get a faster internet connection so I can upload it. Well, that's enough. Let's jump right into the questions and get going for today. This is the way to be. See, I decided to do that instead of the graphic. First question comes from Garrett Bruce. You mentioned that you can only use these in brood boxes. Why is that? And by these, we're talking about the BetterComb pre-drawn synthetic comb. Why is that? In your video, BetterComb in bedding with wire reinforcement prevents sagging from Better Bee exclusively. You discuss using the BetterComb and the Super. Is there a difference between the two products in the two videos that lets you use them in the Supers as well? Well, because when BetterComb, for those of you who don't know, and a lot don't, it's pre-drawn synthetic beeswax. Chemically, it is extremely similar to actual wax produced by bees. We did lots of testing with it. It comes, as described here, exclusively from BetterBee.com, and it's called BetterComb. And around the world, it's known as Hexacell, so it's the same stuff. Advantage, you get pre-drawn cells so the bees can go to work right away. So it's swarm season. So those of you who collect swarms, I do too, if you can, if they're your own. And for me, because again, I'm trying to do biosecurity on my bee yard this year. We're going to talk a little bit about that this year too. So anyway, the pre-drawn stuff gives your bees an immediate resource. When it first came out, they wanted you to put toothpicks in it. If only I had some of it. So I've got it right here. This is, and again, this is going to address another question. Lots of BetterComb questions today. This is what it looks like, and this is for a medium super. See that? It looks just like regular drawn out foundation, all the frames. This is very important because it's not beeswax, even though it looks like it, feels like it, and the bees use it the same. It has to say BetterComb on the back of it because you want to know where you're putting it. When they first came out with it, there were holes along the sides, as there are here. There were holes along the top and holes along the bottom, and they gave you a little packet of toothpicks, and you broke off the toothpicks and you stuck them in there. And you held your BetterComb in place. And let me tell you something, that did not work out too well, because down in places like Texas, places where it got really hot, and even this year, up here in the state of Pennsylvania, northeastern United States, there were BetterComb frames where it had, like, it bulges out. So now, they changed and say to wire all of it. So if it's in your brood box, if it's up in your medium supers and things like that, you want to wire it. This is wired. Now, they did have it where you could buy the frames from Better Bee already wired, and I just checked because I was going to talk about it today, and I wanted to be able to tell you where to get it, what to do. And the pre-wired frames are out of stock. So the next recommendation I could make for that would be to get the kit. I did a video about that, and that's what's described here, the embedding video that I did. Where I have the kit, because you get the whole roll of wire, you get the little grommets and everything to the eyelets for running it through the sidebars. That's the best way to go. Economical, because you do it all yourself, unless you pick your own frames for it. So yes, you can put it up in your honey super. Yes, it holds up to extraction, and the more the bees use it, they reinforce it, and it's just as strong as other comb. And likewise, just as delicate as brand new drawn comb. So the way it comes out of the box, when you put it in there, treat it the same way you would if your bees were establishing themselves brand new. And we all know how soft that first comb is when it is made by the bees. Well, BetterComb is much the same. So it would deflect, and if you give it a centrifugal force against the side, the face of the comb, instead of, they have tangential extractors and radial extractors. So a radial extractor would put less stress on the face of the comb. See what I'm saying? So it is usable. And at the time that I made the first video about BetterComb, we just had the toothpicks. I wasn't a fan of that anyway to begin with the toothpicks. Because they didn't even give you enough toothpicks. What tightwads they were on that. And so then I was really glad when we went the embedding method. Much better. And now, every time I come across the BetterComb, if it's deformed at all and it's held in there with toothpicks, I pull it, swap it out. So the difference between the two products, wire it. And it is the same composition, the same material. There are people that profoundly dislike it. And there's a little undercurrent against it, and that's because it is not beeswax. So if you are rendering beeswax to make some kind of pharmaceutical, or if you are going to sell that as a balm or some kind of healing thing, and you're using real beeswax in it, if you have BetterComb in there, you can't say it's real beeswax. Did kind of an intermediate dive on that and found that some of the cosmetics users were actually allergic to real beeswax. Why? What's in it? Well, the residue in 99.9% of the beeswax and wax foundation that you get here in the United States today has pesticide residue already in it. So the BetterComb is pesticide residue free. And so when I looked into the cosmetics industry and how they use beeswax, they actually were showing a preference for the synthetic waxes over the actual beeswax, because of those toxins that were present. So, but if you want real beeswax and you put frames of BetterComb in your hive, you no longer can claim that that hive, the wax that comes out of it, is 100% beeswax. So maybe more of an answer than was requested, but I have to say that kind of thing because sometimes people get confused. It is chemically virtually identical to beeswax, but it is not made by bees. So, next question, number two, Andrew Mallard. And this is from Kent, England. Could you do a piece on swarm traps? I just caught my first swarm, but realized I'm getting it wrong. Typical newbie mistakes, I suppose. The mistakes I made, one, didn't put the trap in the location I wanted it to be finally placed, unless I'm moving it, say, 2 miles or by 4 feet every day. I assume I can wait until winter to remedy this. I provided an entrance through the roof. I nailed the box to a base. No thought given to this at all, so I couldn't put a crown board. So I think a crown board is an interior inner cover. So I couldn't put a crown board on it, and they nested in the roof. Insufficient frames, so I had to go in and add frames disturbing the bees. In the meantime, temperatures around the mid-20s Celsius here in my location, and swarming is happening. Missed one swarm. So anyway, there are things I want to talk about here. Actually, I get a lot of swarm questions this time of year. I think every beekeeper does. And if you're a new beekeeper, you're looking at collecting swarms and things like that. But there's some things in here that I want to give you some things to think about. The thing here is the mistake I made is it didn't put the trap in the location I wanted it to be finally placed. Well, swarm traps are not put where you want to keep your hives ultimately. Why not? Well, because we're trying to attract the scout bees to check them out, and then we want a swarm to move right into it. Therefore, we tend to ideally, and this is based on statistics that have proven out, the ideal location for a swarm trap is about 250 yards from your actual apiary or the target apiary that you hope to collect swarms from. How high should it be? Well, about 12 feet. So what should it face? South to southeast, and face an opening and have a clear flyway to it, but at the same time be somewhat sheltered. And the box itself should be strong, sturdy, well secured so that the bees would feel comfortable moving into it, and normally a single entrance down low. You do not want to be keeping your own final hive and managing them in that location, 12 feet off the ground, in a tree, 200 yards from your apiary. And again, yes, they can occupy boxes closer or farther, but when the tests were done and the observations were made, they did elliptical tests, you know, in 10-meter increments outgoing from the apiary in every direction, and they found out which ones got occupied the first, with all other configurations being the same, right about 200 meters got the most traction. So, once you, because a lot of people ask questions about swarms today, you want to put your swarm box out there. There are lots of instructions online on how to make them, and you can buy them. Everything from the swarm troopers, which come from the Blythewood Bee Company. There might be other sources for that. That's a lightweight one that straps to trees. It's got the straps and buckles built in. It holds 5 frames. Most of them do. Tom Seeley, the Honeybee Democracy, he describes exactly what the bees are looking for as far as location, height, cavity space, and everything else. Horizontalhives.com, Dr. Leo Sharishkin also gives you lots of instruction on how to make your own swarm box. So there's lots of information out there for that. But what I want to say is that once those bees occupy that swarm box, once they move in, the very first overnight that they have, ideally you would zip out there early in the morning before they start foraging again, because the foragers that are out, you're going to lose them. You're not going to get them in your bee box. And you hike those right back home, and you transfer those frames right into the final nest box, the final brood box that they're going to be in, and go from there. Any scouts that are out and about that maybe spent the night away from that swarm box, they will come back to look, and when they don't find it, where will they ultimately go? Well, they return to the original hive that they ultimately emitted from. So the swarm was cast from original colony of bees somewhere, hopefully in a bee tree. I have one swarm this year that is not from my own apiary, and it's caught from a bee tree. So I'm really excited about that because it's a feral colony of bees in a great big maple tree. So that was cool. Anyway, when your swarm box gets occupied, don't waste any time getting it out of there and into your new hive location where you ultimately want to keep it. And what else should you be doing based on what I've told you in the past? Have another swarm box ready to go and put it right in the exact same spot, because often more than one swarm is targeting the same location and one just happened to beat the others into it. It is not unusual, which is another reason why you want to empty out that swarm box and transfer those into your final beehive in your apiary as quickly as you can. It's because often within 24 hours, another swarm of bees moves right into the exact same location. So now you can get multiple swarms right away and then leave it up there. A lot of people this year have more swarms than they can even handle. But those were some concerns I had here, because this whole thing about moving it, say, 2 miles or 4 feet every day, that's if you have an established colony in your bee yard and you want to rearrange your bee yard. Wintertime is a great opportunity to do that, but this moving it in increments, that's why that comes into play. Or hauling them away several miles for a week or more, and then ultimately bringing them back at night and installing them again where you ultimately want them to be. Those are two different things. Established hive, swarm that you've just captured. Swarm that you just captured, move it right away. Be good to go. Next question, number 3, Andrew Mallard. I added a new queen on Monday this week. We introduced the queen in her cage, and my mentor suggested they were readily accepting her, so we led her straight into the hive. I'll be checking the hive shortly to see what she is doing, but hopefully lots of new brood. I'm happy with what we did, but what are your feelings about this? Direct releasing your queen is an advanced activity, in my opinion. You want to be able to read the bees really well. You get your queen, she's in this queen cage, or one similar. When you go to put this into a hive, if this queen did not come with those bees, so introduce a queen in her cage, and my mentor suggested, so it doesn't say if they came with the package, if you have an established hive that's queenless, things like that. You want to make sure that if it's a package or a nucleus, obviously the nucleus, the queen is loose, so that doesn't apply. If you have a package of bees, the queen is in the cage and she's with bees, that she's just getting to know in transit. So when we put them in the hive, the behavior of the bees towards the queen in her cage lets you know whether or not they're accepting and feeding her or trying to sting and acting aggressive to her. So, and I'll put a link to a video that I made showing you the difference between those that you can direct release and those that you don't. If you're brand new to beekeeping and you're not certain about how to assess whether or not those bees are accepting that queen before you let her out of her cage, leave the candy plug in the cage and let that queen sit in there in the center where she'll be warm directly over the entrance area in a frame so that the bees can get to know her, start to spread her queen mandibular pheromone around and know that they belong to her. Plus that gives you that 72 hours that they'll chew through that candy, which is nothing but powdered sugar and water, and they'll release the queen and any workers that are with her. So if you're new, it's best to let that happen over a period of 3 days. Now this ties into something else. I didn't have this question printed out today, but a lot of people have sent me statements more than questions, knowing that they have to keep their queens in their cages for at least 10 days. Okay, please don't do that. See, that's the other extreme. Direct release is immediate, huge gamble. 3 days, pretty standard. Let the bees chew, release the queen while she's getting introduced and their pheromone is getting spread around. But the other thing is, now if you're going to wait 10 days, what have you lost? You have lost thousands of bees this year, because every day that that queen is in her cage, those of you who've been watching, I say this all the time, every day she's in this cage, she's not laying. Every day that she's not laying, assuming that there are cells there for her to lay in, you're missing approximately 1,500 eggs a day, which 21 days out from that, you're missing 1,500 new workers per day. Spread that out over 3 days or a week or 10 days. Now we've got 14, 15,000 bees that were delayed in hatching out. So I don't like the 10-day wait at all. I don't see the point behind it. 72 hours, pretty standard. If you're absolutely positive that they're accepting her, then go ahead and let her out. So there you go. And watch the video, having a mentor there who knows what they're doing. I think it's great for those of you who have mentors, because it is an advanced practice to assess the queen, see what her behavior is towards the worker, see how agitated she is, and see if they're going to let her out on their own in 3 days, or if you can release them right to the queen right away and get laying. Get into production. It's May. Oops, it's June. So anyway, yeah, June already. So this is it. This is your month of increase. Next question, number 4. Be kind to be free is the name of this person's YouTube. How can one encourage bees to draw comb? We had 2 large hives, overwintered, drawn double deeps with new medium supers on top. We saw that they were building swarm cells in early May, so we split hives and gave them more room. With the May warm-up, there was all kinds of pollen and nectar coming in, which they backfilled into the hatched brood cells, and we missed a swarm cell somewhere in one of the hives swarmed about 2 weeks ago. Neither hive touched their new supers. We have tried spraying frames with 1-to-1, layering more wax on the foundation, purchasing acorn foundation, removing the queen excluders, shaking frames of bees into the medium supers, and yet we don't have one flake of new wax. So this gets into what makes your bees produce wax to begin with. And it's like a lot of other things. When the colony is healthy, when it's queen right, when everything is in balance, they make new infrastructure. If they're making plans to get out of there, what would be an example of them making plans to get out of there? Oh, a queen cell. A swarm cell, which is where they're making a new queen. Once they start doing that, they start to back off on infrastructure production. If they're absent a queen at all, like the old queen is gone, there's been a swarm, and the new queen hasn't hatched, they're queenless. They don't do a lot of wax building, a lot of infrastructure. They just don't. And as noted here, they do continue to bring in pollen because they're still brood, and they do continue to bring in nectar resources because the bees need that carbohydrate. Every bee in the hive has a crop. Every bee in the hive has to consume carbohydrates to survive, including the drones, those beggars. So what won't they be doing? They won't be wasting those resources on new wax because they have no reason. They're not inspired to produce wax. So that's one thing. So not queen right, no queen mandibular pheromone working their way through from a fertile laying queen. So they're kind of waiting to see if they need to expand or if they're getting ready to just decline and die out in the absence of a queen. The next thing is the space too big? Now, these are statistical generalities. There can be unique circumstances and bees that make comb for no reason whatsoever, but these are what happens most often. So then, if you have a space that's too big for them, they also tend to not do a lot of comb construction. I don't know why. They just don't. If you have a lot of extra boxes and they're not increasing in number, they're also not investing in infrastructure and the space is too big for them. So we always want to size it down right for them. So if you've got a medium super that has frames in it that are not completely drawn out, they're not finished off, then adding more space does not increase the likelihood that they would then build new beeswax comb. So the other part of that is, what do you have to feed them? What has to be coming in for the bees to make comb? So nectar from the floral sources in your area. So nectar that would be coming in would stimulate them. The foragers are bringing it in. The storekeeper bees then would either put the nectar away in cells, or they would stimulate the wax workers to start making more comb because they have a queen. She's going to lay. They need room. We need a nursery. We have to expand things. If you've ever been around and somebody's about to have a baby and they're going through the nesting phase and they're demanding all this new stuff and interior decorators and lots of other rooms and big windows and a bassinet and all this other stuff, it is nothing like with bees. So I don't even know why I went off in that direction, but they need more space for the new babies that are about to come. 21 days out, they're going to be hatching out, but they need spaces for the queen to lay eggs. But if there's no queen laying, they don't need the space. They're not going to do it. See what happens? And the sugar syrup, the 1-to-1 by weight, is, again, what if it's 3/4 to 1? Or what if it's, you know, a little over, a little off? 1-to-1 is just, again, statistically, the most stimulating sugar source for the bees to use to go ahead and activate their wax glands and make new wax so that they can work that up and make new infrastructure. So with all of those things present, space that's not too big, places to build new comb, queen right pheromone, a laying queen, and resources coming in that give them the raw materials to go ahead and metabolize and then make their own wax comb. All of those things play. So that's pretty much it. Let's see. There's more questions to this. Today, 3 swarms, which I almost expected after last week's cold and extended rain, where we couldn't open the hives to inspect. Boxed the largest swarm, and the 2 little ones disappeared. I'm thinking about trying to locate queens in these 2 large original hives, blocking the queens in the lower deep by placing a queen excluder and new undrawn medium between the brood boxes. Provided enough bees remain to keep the brood warm, I'll stop splitting the brood pattern. I don't know what else to try. We have 8 hives from all the splitting and swarms and a just-in-case nucleus purchased. Silly me. With little drawing comb to speak of, other than the deep brood boxes they overwintered in, are we being too impatient? So it's not about impatience, although new beekeepers, you want everything to expand fast and get things going, but that's it. Hopefully I answered that with what they needed to get going. And here's question number 5, Mick Sugra. I know it's a stupid question, but can you use BetterComb in a medium super, right? I don't plan on ever extracting it. The medium is for the bees over winter. My mentor here says, don't use it in the medium, but I'm pretty sure I've seen in your videos where you said it was okay to use, right? I made up 10 frames with the wire and plan to use it in my second hive. Started this year to give them a leg up. Yes, This is, we talked about this earlier. Yes, you can use the BetterComb in your medium supers for the bees or for extraction. No difference. It will work now. Also, I recommend that you get the whole wiring kit, make your own. It's much better that way, cheaper. You'll always have it if you ever need it. Question number 6, Michael Kennedy. Fred, do you clip your queen's wings? How do you feel about clipping queens as a swarm management strategy? Can you describe how you clip the wings? Thanks, Michael Kennedy. Here's the thing. I've clipped a few, and I have stuff to talk about on that. Wing clipping goes way back. A lot of people use it. They use it to make sure that queen is theirs and not a queen that has superseded a queen that they once had. Because the markings that we put on the back of our bees, on the thorax of the queen, this year it's white. This is a paint marker. This is an example of what you would use. That can be worn off. That can be groomed off, chewed off, and rubbed off because the queen is rubbing herself in and out of cells all the time to inspect them and then dipping her abdomen down in there to lay an egg. So she's constantly getting wear and tear and things are rubbing off. A clipped wing does not rub off. Now, a lot of people get upset because you have maimed or injured your queen, and that is true. You have clipped the wings. So she is no longer 100% natural, but the bees do not reject her. So you're actually okay with that, but the marking is better. But here's the other thing. I did that to a queen that I didn't want to have her completely get away. So when she swarmed, because it doesn't stop swarming. Clipped wing queen heads out. She just can't fly well. She lands nearby and a cluster of bees lands with her. If she can't continue to fly, here's the other end of that. Don't do this unless you're in an area where you can see your bees all the time, frequently, like every coffee break you take, like I do. You go out there and sip your coffee and listen to see if there's any swarms happening, which happened a couple days ago because it sounded like a swarm, but it's just massive orientation flights from new bees. But if you're not local and you can't tend to them right away, there's almost no point in clipping the wings of the queen. Because if you clip wings on one side of the queen and she flies out and she's local and you're not there to find her, what's going to happen? They're going to swarm anyway. If they can't move with her, they're going to go back to the hive and they're going to leave her out there and she's just going to die. And you're not going to find her because there won't be a cluster of bees around her, or it'll be so tiny it won't get your attention, potentially. So that's one thing. The other thing is, if the queen can't fly, she's still going to try to because she doesn't know she can't fly. They still do everything else to her in order to prepare her to depart. So they're still cutting back on her feed. They are still pushing her around and keeping her active inside the hive so she can lose weight so she can be light enough to fly. Another thing that if this doesn't work and the queen doesn't fly out, do you know what else happens? They're doing that in preparation for new queens to hatch out of the queen cells. And this is where inspecting at reasonable intervals comes into play, because you want to catch these queen cells and know biologically what's going on with your hive. Is your hive pregnant? What's a pregnant hive look like? Well, they're making queen cells. So the old queen is going to have to leave. Now, if she can't leave, what's going to happen? One of those new virgin queens is going to hatch out. She will not have left. And guess who leaves with the swarm? The virgin queen. See, so we didn't really stop it, but we kept that valuable. If it's genetically really valuable to keep that queen around, then you can do that. And again, you have to be vigilant. You have to know that you're going to be out there and notice that when she goes out there, because the time, the window of opportunity for that, for you to collect them and get them back in another hive. Don't put her back in the original hive because she'll just have to swarm out again. But she's doing that just a couple days in advance of brand new queens hatching out. And again, they're going to swarm as virgins. But if there's just a couple of queen cells left behind, that new queen's going to hatch and she's going to do mating flight and she's going to come back and she's going to occupy the hive. She won't do that if there's queen mandibular pheromone from another queen. So what the end result also might be, lots of contingencies. The other result might be that they turn on the new hatching queen and they kill her off. The workers can even do that sometimes because a resident queen never departed. So there's lots of complications involved here. So my suggestion is, if she's not critical genetically, if this is not some kind of super hive that's top performing and there's no Varroa and all that other stuff, that's a queen worth keeping. But then you want to stay ahead of, which is much better than clipping her wings. Although I'm not against wing clipping under the right circumstances. So you want to stay ahead of it by noticing what's going on in your hive, because they're not going to swarm unless they have replacements on the way. So routine inspections will help you out with that, especially on your critical colonies. You want to know what's going on. So I hope that answers that question. Do I? Have I? Yes, I have. And those are the reasons why I have, and why most of my hives have bees in them that have, the queens are not clipped with their wings. Number 7, Raisin Spirituality is the name of this YouTuber. Is there a known diameter that allows a single honeybee to pass through safely? Would a circle-shaped opening be better than, say, an ellipse? Which is a very interesting question. And Brazen Spirituality did not go into detail about why the question is even being asked. What kind of a hole can they pass through? By looking at the hive, what can we tell? What size hole a worker bee needs to pass through? The diameter of the cell, which normally is given in millimeters, because they can work, they can pass through that. And sometimes there'll be a cell in the upper third of a frame of naturally drawn comb where they've chewed a hole through it, and bees tend to disappear through that cell. It's like, what is going on there? It's like going to, you know, the circus and seeing a whole bunch of little people coming out of a tiny fire truck, and they just keep coming one after another, so many. Well, there's another hole somewhere, and they're getting in and they're coming out. So it just looks like they're all coming out of that cell, that tiny car. But what they're really doing is it's a hole. So if you want to allow a single bee to pass, then roughly a quarter inch. You can also go 5 millimeters, and that is not hard and fast, but do you want the workers to go through and not drones, for example, and not the queen, for example? So then even queen excluder openings let you know what the diameter could be. The other thing is, we know what bee space is, that is 3/8 of an inch. So if you made bee space, you made a hole 3/8 of an inch, then we can have 2. See, so a quarter inch for a single passage. It is instrumental in providing, for example, a tiny upper vent that is easily defended. That's because if you manage just a quarter inch in diameter, then the little worker bees can line up in there and block it. They can also keep air from passing through it. They just collect in there in a little row and stop air from passing. So be interested to know why the question is being asked, but that's it. So 5 millimeter hole or a quarter inch drill bit would be just fine for that. Next question, number 8, James Townsend. Just wanted to share a situation I discovered last week. I have slatted racks on my 2 bottom hives. Both have been trying to swarm like crazy, did splits, and the queens and queen cells. I introduced a new queen after removing all queen cells. 3 days later, they swarmed. My mated queen was gone. I'll talk to you about that in a second. I got the swarm and virgin queen is now laying. Now I will get to the point. I did some more digging and found under the slatted rack a 16-inch by 2-inch length of comb built into a U full of drawn comb and 2 emerged queen cells. Sneaky bees. I removed and froze the comb. Just wanted to share that so maybe it will help someone else. And other people have asked about the bees drawing wax on the bottom sides of slatted racks. For those of you who don't know, that's a slatted rack right there, and there is a space under it. See right here? When you put this right side up. So there's a space under here, and now we're talking about the comb that gets drawn down. Well, every hive that I inspect now, I pull up that slatted rack, and I look at it while everything falls over there. I look under it to see if they are building comb down there, and they haven't. But guess what one hive was doing? Because I did a split, and I used my cell phone and videoed a bunch of it. The frame going above the slatted rack had a swarm cell on it, and there were 2 frames in a row, one right after the other. Each had the same configuration swarm cell. So there's a queen cell down there, really long, and because the slatted rack is in line with this, that queen cell extended down into that opening pretty far. So in a normal hive, for example, we would load this in there and the queen cell couldn't have gone so low. It would have just been smushed right up against the bottom. So I used that to make splits. But they did that. They've not built comb under my slatted racks so far. But it is worth checking, because what else do people like to do under their slatted racks? They like to put their oxalic acid vaporization pans under there. And if there's beeswax, it could catch fire. Now you set your hive on fire. So definitely look at that stuff before you do anything. So the other thing is, the $65 queen disappeared. Just did a new install. How can we keep the queen in there? Well, I showed this earlier. This is something that I've only recently even knew was on the market, but it makes perfect sense. This is a queen excluder. Look at the frame that's on it. This sets right on the landing board. Here's your hive entrance, sits on the landing board right in front of it, and it is ideal for someone who is installing a brand new queen and they don't want that queen to fly away, or for your bees to all of a sudden swarm and cut out and leave you without a decision about the queen. $65 down the tube, no thank you. So you want to keep this closed up on there long enough for the queen, because who can get through this? All the workers can get through it, but queens can't get through it, and drones can't get through it. That's why you don't leave it on for a really long time. But I would have no problem with leaving this on here until you can inspect, so a week down the road after you install a new queen, because we don't want to be too disruptive. You can actually cause a colony of bees to reject a newly installed queen if they associate that with a lot of disruption, smoking, other activities that are detrimental to the colony that provides stress to the bees. So wait a week to 10 days, then do your inspection and see that there are eggs being laid, that there's new larvae present, and the queen is accepted and doing her thing. So then take this off. And what I like about this is just on the front, just pull it right off of there. Or just, you know, leave it there to make sure she stays long enough, 4 or 5 days, and then don't disrupt them at all. Just pull this off. See how that goes. But those things from Blythewood Bee Company got nothing to do with it, of course. But I bought these from Blythewood Bee Company. And other thing that occurred to me that these could be good for, sometimes when you're doing oxalic acid vaporization treatment, of course, you have to close off the entrances. And because I use a ProVape 110, I run that through a quarter inch hole through the back of the hive. So we have to block the entrances with damp cloths usually. So this thing has pretty good weight to it. So you could just wrap a cloth around this, not extend the ends, of course, and it fits right on the landing board and covers that entrance. So possibly a good tool for those who are using oxalic acid vaporization. Anyway, what else do we have? Slatted racks, blah, blah, hiding the queen. Sneaky bees. That was part of my response. Question number 9. Greg Stoddard, Gavin's Gansvort, New York. Anyway, sorry. Oh, yeah. This is a request to support somebody who's doing bee research. So this is something that people ask. Well, I'm on the end here of talking about things for fun. Don't forget to look into Hives for Heroes. That's another thing to check out if you're trying to support people doing stuff. So if your bee club has a whole pile of cash hanging around and you're looking for something to support, what Gregory wanted me to know about here is in the May 2021 American Bee Journal, which a lot of people just put ABJ when they're referencing it, so if that confused you, Dr. Jamie Ellis was asked how beekeepers can help further research. Money would be a huge help. The USDA researcher, Dr. Samuel Ramsey. If you don't know who that guy is, Google it and watch some of his videos. This guy is a bright spot in the area of Varroa destructor mite research. He got his doctorate through that research, and this dude is a hot ticket when it comes to handling this kind of stuff. But apparently, Dr. Ramsey has discovered information about Varroa that have completely changed everything we believed for 30 years. He's the guy, by the way, that discovered, if you read a lot of old textbooks and stuff, it will say old, I mean, 10 years plus. It will say that the Varroa destructor mite, for example, feeds on the hemolymph of the worker bees and the pupa and things like that. Well, the hemolymph is the blood, but it actually feeds on the fat bodies stored in the bee and vectors their diseases that way. And Dr. Ramsey disclosed that behavior. And he has incredible electron microscope images and things like that. Fantastic lecturer. He's making the circuit. But apparently, in order for his research to continue, he has a GoFundMe page. So if you're looking to support someone, and people often are, They want to support something that's going to benefit beekeepers around the world who are dealing with varroa mites. Go to Dr. Samuel Ramsey's GoFundMe page. I'm sure you can find it with a Google search. If I find it, I'll put the link down in the video description before, along with any other links that might be helpful to people today. And motivate them to be proactive about the challenges we face. Finance, research, and so on. Okay, so there, I did that. And Hives for Heroes. And this is the fluff section. And this was interesting to do. Somebody else wrote me an email today, this morning, and asked me to, just gave me a YouTube link and said, go check this out. And it was Bob Binney. Bob Binney is a big commercial beekeeper, and he does a whole lecture series, and he's got a lot of really good, useful information. And the thing about it was, he was showing one of his bee yards, and there's a bee researcher that was going to use some of his bee yards for varroa mite research. And the problem that they had, and I'll try to put a link down below if I can find it. If not, go to Bob Binney's YouTube channel and look at the varroa problem. The problem is that they needed the varroa mites in order to test out some kind of new method of control for varroa mites. And guess what? This whole apiary, and I'm talking piles of beehives, did not have varroa mites in them. He said they found one. And he attributed that to his treatment with oxalic acid vaporization of his hives during winter, during the low brood periods. Now, people like me go into your hives in the wintertime, end of November, 1st of December, and you get this incredible efficacy with varroa mite treatments with oxalic acid vaporization. But I do a single treatment because it hammers the mites, like, so easy. Because in low brood periods, the mites are phoretic, they're exposed, therefore this oxalic acid works extremely well. So that's what he did, but he did a whole series of them. So I will let him speak for himself on that, because he's in a much better position as a commercial beekeeper, well-respected, thousands of hives, and people have used his outyards in the past for parts of research that are things like Randy Oliver's research with the shop towel method of glycerin towels and slow delivery of oxalic acid for the bees. And there are a lot of things that are not approved for use. So I would get in a pickle if I told people to super overdose everything, but it makes sense what Bob Binney is saying, so I send you to him to find out more about that. And I don't know what's going on, because here in Pennsylvania, now we had a rough spring, so I actually like that because it held the bees back. I wasn't ready to deal with inspections and splits and things like that to prevent swarming. So the cold weather that we had, the wet weather that we had, and the 50-degree weather helped slow the bees down and keep their numbers low so that I could get out there and do inspections. I've done more inspections of hives this year than any other year previous. And one of the things that I'm finding a lack of is also a lack of varroa mites. So I don't know if this is going, you know, to be something that a lot of people are talking about. I don't know what your varroa loads are like this year. But also in the Pennsylvania State Beekeepers Association, they put out this newsletter, and they have a segment called Ask Two Beekeepers, but then they have three people here because you're going to get multiple answers from two beekeepers. But one of our commercial beekeepers, in fact, the president of my beekeeping association, he has no mites. And that's commercial level. That's not my backyard. I have like 17, 16 colonies of bees. Now, for me not to have mites, that's no big deal. I'm pretty isolated right now, and I had really good luck controlling the mites late last year, so we had a good winter for me in areas where people did not have good winters. The other thing is Charlie here also did not have a good winter with his commercial operation. He had a lot of bee losses, so the idea that the varroa mite numbers now are non-detectable at this point is really good news. So I'm hoping that maybe something's going on with the varroa mites. I don't know. What are your mite numbers like? Do you normally have high mites and you don't this year? And if you don't, what did you treat with? So for me, the only treatment I use is oxalic acid vaporization, although I have Formic Pro at hot standby, just in case I got a hive that just exploded with varroa mites. The other thing is, we've learned some stuff about that. Remember, we're just talking now, just shooting the breeze. So we've learned some stuff about the varroa mites and treatments and things like Formic Pro. Formic Pro is some smelly stuff, so I don't know if you've ever used it. And what happens is the bees, you have to really vent it. So the bees all collect on the outside of the hive and everything else. Well, guess what else the bees do? They zip over to other hives. They don't like where they're living right now. It's being treated. They move into other hives. They might move in with their own Varroa destructor mite load. So you actually could be spreading the mites around your small apiary. I'm targeting backyard beekeepers. So the other thing of it is, I've asked a lot of questions about that. So how do we know if we've got a really strong colony that's doing well and we're going to treat a colony over here? I wanted to move my high mite load colonies, which is why I'm doing so many mite inspections this year, to an outyard, to another space, not my apiary. And then keep only the ones that are top performers, super groomers. I got great video of grooming behavior on the entrances of different hives in my apiary this year. So they're also grooming like crazy, which is really interesting and may have a direct impact on the bees' ability to rear Varroa destructor mites in their brood. So there's a lot going on, but I wanted to pass it on because one of the things Bob Binney was doing, and one of the ways that he got his control, and he suggested it even would work with capped brood. So he overdoses them. He gives them 4 grams, I think he said. But rather than quote me, go watch his video, listen to what he's got to say, and see what you think of that. Tell him I sent you there. He'll be surprised because he has no idea who I am. So anyway, yeah, go check out Bob Binney. So that's the other thing. Also, don't forget that there's over 100 of these, so you might click a thumbs up down here to remind yourself that you've already watched this video. The other thing is, I keep using now that digital record keeping method. It's called Beekeep Pal, which I'm using on my phone, tablet, and my computer. One of the things that I thought was funny is once you've done an inspection on one of your hives and entered it into your little digital record there, they send you emails letting you know, oh, hive number A3 has not been inspected for 21 days. So you get these ticklers. So if you're ignoring one of the colonies or something's going on, that was something I really didn't realize that they do. So they're sending that in. They've also made changes to add different hive configurations to it. So it's that is a method for keeping track of your colonies and bees and everything else that's constantly evolving. So the other thing I wanted to talk to you about before I close out. Oh, and at the end of today's video, I'm going to show you the walkthrough inspection of the Long Langstroth hive that I built that died over winter. So I installed a Saskatrass package in them, and you will see that at the end of this video. So you can see how they're doing. They're really strong. They're doing fantastic. It's another colony that does not have Varroa mites in it. So again, we're Varroa clean right now. If it stays like that, it's going to be really fantastic. This is a little queen cage that comes to cover your queen cells. When you're making your own queens, when you're doing your own grafting, there's another system called the NICOT system, NICOT. And that has the queen bee putting her eggs right into the queen cups for you. And then you take those out and you put them in the racks and you put them in a starter colony that's queenless that will start the queen cells for you and draw them out. Well, I take these little things because they look like little hair curler deals. And I put this piece of malleable plastic that after you work it, it stays workable for like 30 minutes and then it sets up nice and strong. I carry this in my pocket. So if I come across the queen, I get her in there. Close that up because it's one-handed, and then you can just put this in your pocket, and your queen won't overheat out in the sun while you work your hive. If you're doing a split or something, then you know you've got your queen, and once you put the split into its new location, re-release the queen. So here's another clip style that I highly recommend. Now, if all you're doing is finding your queen and you want to pin her down so you can mark her, you could get something like this. It's got little tines in it, and you find the queen on the surface. Maybe you're not comfortable picking her up because you don't want to hurt her. So there she is on the face of the comb. How would that work? Let's take a piece of BetterComb. So then if the queen was like right here, then you push this in just like that, and it holds the queen. And then you get your marking pen after you do lots of test marking. And then you'll be able to mark her thorax with your white dot if you haven't already marked your queen. So actually, that's a good way, I think, to display that. So that holds the queen in place. You can hold her on that frame while you do the rest of your inspection and things like that. Lots of queen marking opportunities. And that's it for today. So I'm glad you watched. Thank you for being here, whether it's by podcast or through YouTube. If you're not a subscriber, I invite you to subscribe. And take care of your honeybees, and thanks for learning with me, and I hope you have a fantastic weekend. So today as a bonus, I'm going to walk you through my Long Langstroth hive inspection update. The package was installed back on April the 28th from Man Lake. This is a Saskatras package, and the inspection date for this is June 3rd, so it's yesterday. Thought I'd toss this on the tail end of today's Q&A video. So they're actually doing really well, and what am I filming this with before anybody asks? I'm shooting this with a GoPro Hero 9 Black Edition, so it's not going to be up to speed with my normal stuff, but easy to grab and show you excerpts because I did this working alone, of course. These bees are extremely calm. We're looking at the outermost frame, so I pulled the divider board away, and we're seeing naturally drawn comb hanging here. You see some bees on the right there festooning. That's when they hang on to each other's toes, and they're getting ready to make more comb. So they're really doing fantastic. And there is some brood already on the end there, as well as nectar being stored, so it looks cool. I pull the frames out, I put them on this rack that I've made. One of the advantages of this horizontal hive, lots of extra space. I have oak cover boards with bee space underneath of them, so the bees can move around on top of these frames, but notice they're not building any bird comb over that, so that's working out really well. And then we get in here, look at the population of these bees. Now it is overcast right now, but it is 70 degrees Fahrenheit during this inspection, so the bees are actually pretty calm. We see lots of drones scooting around in here, which does not bother me in the least. And I marked these. That's a Hoover frame down there. And this is more brood. You see some pollen lower right there. And this frame has heavy waxed plastic foundation, and the bees are still building it out. It looks like the queen is using all of the frames equally for her laying. Look, top left there, there's some developing larvae. And then, of course, right next to the larvae, super convenient, lots of pollen stored. So that's terrific. Looking around here, some of these fat bees, people look at them and think they're seeing the queen. They're not. They're just drones hanging out looking for a meal. Nice and quiet, this group here too. We see a lot of nectar on this one. Got some capped honey here, top left corner, lower left corner, they're capping that off. So we are white clovers coming in. Nice resource for the bees. And I do not see the queen, although I see evidence of her everywhere. She is moving through this hive. Look at this. And now we're seeing some of those drone cells. See how big and fat they are, lower right. Big, fat, dark drone cells right next to them, some worker cells, so great comparison opportunity there. Again, we have capped brood. We have lots of open larvae right there about the center now. Nice and white, shiny, lots of food in there for them, so that's the other thing we're looking at. Bees are quiet, just going about their work like I'm not even here. Nice. Easy going. And when you see these sequences, I've pulled the frame out and I'm hanging them up on my display rack, which sits on top of the oak panel, so if any of the bees fell off or the queen was on here, I wouldn't lose her. Look at this foundationless frame here. Again, lots of brood. Lower right there, that top right opening space is where we put the queen cage when we initially installed this. They've not sealed it up yet. And they're attached well. Again, this is completely built by the bees. No foundation on this frame. Just wanted to see how they built that out, and considering the amount of time that we've had, a little over a month, they've made all this progress. This was the hive that was the dead out, of course, in spring. We did that review of it, and we pulled the old brood frames out, so everything here is new and fresh. I don't mind that it will take them extra time to do it. Look at all the pollen here. Dead center about now. We've also got capped brood again. And some stretched out deeper cells top left, and we've got the cover that is wax caps of the stored honey. Lower right, more brood, lots of pollen. To the left, more brood, and upper left, see the comparison? That's capped honey.
So it's a great opportunity to look at all of that there. And look at this brood pattern. Again, foundationless frames. We let the bees build everything, which uses a lot of their resources, but I don't mind because this is the experimental hive. And surprise, surprise, not feeding these bees. We did feed for the first week after the package was installed because we wanted to get them going. But they're doing great on their own. Now this frame has acorn foundation in it, heavy waxed. And it's funny too because some of the cells are really thin there, top right, and they already capped the honey there, like not even an eighth of an inch deep. So once honey was ripe, they just capped it up. Now during this inspection, I'm also checkerboarding in some pre-drawn comb and some more frames for them to draw out. We don't want them to run out of space. Look at this nice, clean looking foundationless comb. And they're just going gangbusters. What are those cells? Center. That is capped brood again. So these are worker cells. But you look at the edges to the left there, you see how the cells get a little larger at the edges, and you'll find that they are producing drones again. So we would have about 20% in a really healthy colony would be drone population. So we've seen eggs in here. We've got larvae. We've got a queen somewhere. I have my queen clip handy. If I see her, I grab her, and I'm going to mark her with my white dot and put her back on there, but I don't see the queen anywhere. Lots of fat drones. One of the ways, you know, you squint your eyes and look at the behavior of the bees, but I did not see her. We closed it up. We added frames. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We've got 11 frames in here now. We're going to close it up. So we added 4 new frames in here, and we're going to follow up. Follower board's in. They're nice and quiet. We have that space above the backs of the frames again. Now you see the burr comb built up? That's because of the feeder hole right there. So that's where they put that up. Got to blow these bees out of the way a little bit so I can put this red oak cover board in there. I really like the cover boards, I have to say. Keeps the bees calm. Not only that, the areas of the frames that you want to keep covered during your initial inspections, you can help keep warmth in there. By the way, I'm wearing a nitrile glove there. I'd like to point out that that does not prevent the bees from stinging you. Somebody wrote me and said that they wore nitrile gloves and got stung through them. So it's just to keep your fingers from getting sticky. This is the outside landing board activity. This is the only entrance, 1/2 inch by 6 inches long. A lot of people are asking about the plans to this horizontal long Langstroth hive. I still haven't put those up on the website yet, and that's because I still may make modifications. Sorry for the delay on that, but it is working out great. Hopefully we'll go through another year with them. We'll do more frequent inspections and try not to go into winter without a queen, which is one of the things we did last year. They seem to have lost their queen early. There was also evidence of varroa, even though we treated, so we're going to do the varroa counts too. And the varroa this year, the varroa mite counts are yielding, guess what? Almost no varroa. That's throughout the apiary. We have 15 colonies of bees. This was the only package that survived from Man Lake. 3 packages were received, 2 were dead. And this one is going gangbusters. So, for those of you who wanted me to continue with the Saskatrass bees, here we go. Everything's looking great. Thanks for watching today, and I hope you enjoyed this bonus sequence. Have a nice weekend.